So today I want to talk about the Arctic, Greenland, and oil. Now, for a bit of a change, I wanted to spend some time talking about a bit of good news. As it turns out, Greenland has decided to halt exploration of oil and gas. The decision was made in large part due to the impacts of climate change, as well as the effects that it would have to Greenland and its natural environment. Now, I first want to spend some time today looking at Greenland's decision and explore some of that, and then talk about some of the history and details surrounding Arctic gas and oil reserves. So, to start us off, let's take a look at Greenland's own government statement and see what it has to say. Now, an end to oil exploration. It's worth noting that the Greenland Underground contains large unexplored deposits of oil. In fact, a recent study from the Geological Survey of Denmark and Greenland estimates that there are approximately 18 billion de-risked barrels of oil on the west coast alone, and large deposits are expected to hide below the seabed on the east coast as well. Now, it's worth noting that de-risked here is probably being used in the business sense to refer to the fact that they are, in fact, low risk in terms of making a profit. These barrels are likely to make a lot of money. However, the Greenlandic government believes that the price of oil extraction still is, in fact, too high. This is based both on economic calculations, but also it takes into account the impact on climate and the environment as central roles in making the decision. That is a huge thing to see from a government of this kind. It's wonderful to see a government actually taking into account what is usually put to the side as externalities. The way that the climate and the environment is impacted is usually left to someone else to deal with, usually poor people, who end up getting hit by it the most. However, in this case, they are taking a stance against it, and that is something really great to see. The government decided to cease issuing new licenses for oil and gas exploration in Greenland, meaning they will not issue even licenses to begin exploring for new oil and gas reserves. And this is especially worth noting when we take into account that not only is there all that oil, but 148 trillion cubic feet of natural gas off of Greenland. And these steps, of course, were taken for the sake of nature, for the sake of fisheries, for the sake of the tourism industry, and for the sake of businesses on sustainable potentials. So there's a lot there, and when we look at the combination of environment and climate, as well as economic, we see that Greenland is trying to make the best decision for themselves. In this case, the nature itself, of course, is tied to the environment and climate, but the fisheries are both an economic investment that will get damaged in the long run, as well as something that is deeply rooted in the environment and the effect that it might have on wildlife. Furthermore, the tourism industry, of course, would decrease in value if they were to build giant oil rigs off the coast of their island. To make it even a stronger case, rather, in terms of economics, the businesses that could invest themselves into the future of solar, wind, and other forms of renewable energy could, in fact, create better returns than the oil barrels on the island itself. And as noted by one of the ministers on the ministers of Greenland, the Minister of Housing, Infrastructure, Mineral Resources, and Gender Equality, as a society, we must dare to stop and ask ourselves why we want to exploit a resource. Is the decision based upon updated insight and the belief that it is the right thing to do, or are we just continuing business as usual? Is it the position of the Greenlandic government that our country is better off focusing on sustainable development, such as the potential for renewable energy? And these are a lot of great questions. A lot of people look at the status quo and they consider what's already being done as the norm and don't really want to change away from that. However, it's reached a point where it's pretty obvious that oil and gas production is affecting the environment, is affecting the climate, and is having catastrophic effects. This past month, for sure, has been just the beginnings of that. And if we don't start to look towards renewable energy as an alternative, we may end up exacerbating this and making this far worse. And that is something worth considering when we consider the resources that we examine, exploit, and try to pull from the earth, if we are to do so at all. Now, it is also worth noting that this is far from the only place in the Arctic where oil and gas exist. However, it is very important in that it is one less location that oil and gas companies can search for and begin to start finding and exploiting these two resources. And that to me is an objectively good thing. The effects of drilling, creating the infrastructure, setting it all up, and the shipping will have negative impacts on the environment beyond just the impact of using oil and gas for the multitude of ways that we already use it. Greenland represents one area where there will be less immediate damage to the environment. And the reason for that is clear if you look at the details surrounding production in the Arctic. Now, it's worth noting that historically, there are a couple of reasons why the Arctic has largely gone untapped in terms of oil and gas production. The first is that obtaining oil and gas is generally considered to be far more expensive in Arctic regions than other parts of the world for a few reasons. In order to examine that, I bring up a section from the Wilderness Society that talks a little bit about Alaska. Alaska is considered one of the more capital-intensive settings for drilling in the United States. There are nearly 3 months of consecutive darkness every winter in the northern Arctic, which basically means there are 3 months where you're not going to be able to drill, and if you do so, you're going to need some sort of night vision goggles, some sort of way to be able to continue to process it all and maintain the systems in the dark. And that is costly. In the Arctic refuge, the darkness is accompanied by freezing temperatures and weather conditions so harsh that companies need specially designed equipment. The Arctic Ocean pack ice can delay deliveries of materials, personnel, and equipment for long periods, and flights carrying supplies can also experience prolonged delays due to the same freezing temperatures, fog, and high winds. But exploration and other industrial activity is generally limited to winter because in the summer the ground turns to marshy tundra with the stability of a soggy pillow, making it hard to maneuver and stabilize equipment. These conditions are not only getting worse with climate change, but it's becoming even more of a challenge for all of this, both in the summer and winter months. Now, on top of this extremely challenging environment, the isolation of the Arctic refuge makes drilling even more costly. Unlike many other sites that are available for drilling, there is no pre-existing infrastructure. To produce oil there, a company would need to build roads, pipelines, and transport supplies to one of the most remote regions of the world. Drilling can be up to 10 times more expensive in the Arctic than drilling in the lower 48 states. Arctic drilling would require upfront money that, More upfront money than exploration prospects in other parts of the world. With harsh conditions and significant upfront cost, drilling in the Arctic refuge would be a costly endeavor. Even after buying leases for the search of oil, companies could conclude that it's not a wise investment to commit the serious time, capital, and resources to drill in the Arctic. And this has been a long-standing history, where in order for a lot of these companies to potentially make any money, especially if they want to have de-risked barrels of oil, they are going to require these expensive equipments to already be developed. They're going to require that they find ways to deal with these harsh inclement climates, and they have to find a way to be able to work through the darkness and the frigid temperatures. And that's something that's just not very cost-effective in the long run. But given that, there's still been a push to start looking for the oil in these regions. A lot of these companies are very concerned with the idea of when a lot of these areas start to thaw out due to climate change, that perhaps they would already have some of the areas marked. They want to know exactly how many reserves they are and lay claim to them. And that is something, again, worth keeping in mind in all of this. These may not be the areas that are tapped now, but they might be tapped in the near future. Now, it's also worth noting that another big issue is that spills are guaranteed to happen in the Arctic, especially with the frigid temperatures and especially with all the inclement weather. And while this, of course, will have economic effects, the much greater threat comes at the cost of the environment, nature, and wildlife itself, as well as the cultures of people in the area. So, to begin with, it's worth noting that The Real Dangers of Arctic Drilling, and this is an article that goes back to 2012 from Politico. Shell Oil has called it quits for this year's first Arctic drilling rig. First, there was danger of a city-sized chunk of floating ice smashing into the rig just hours after exploratory drilling began. Days later, a test of its oil spill containment dome ended in a tangled mess on the ocean bottom. This is pretty much guaranteed to happen. If it's not the frigid temperatures bursting the pipes as things thaw and cool in extreme temperatures, or the pipes themselves being made frail from the extremely cold temperatures, or at the very least, more likely to burst, then you're gonna find some way for this to go wrong. This is the problem in the Arctic. Spills are going to happen no matter how carefully oil companies and governments are. There are just too many unknowns. America's best scientists and engineers say we know so little about this deep freeze on an environment that we can't fix if Shell or any other oil company breaks it. And that's the worst part of all. There's no way, especially in that climate, with the darkness kicking in or any of the other frigid temperatures or any of the other things that I've mentioned previously, there's no way for us to come in and clean up any of that oil. And for these major companies that have oil spills in perfectly reasonable climates, for them to be drilling in, if they can't even take care of these climates that are not extreme temperatures, then how can we expect them to in any way, shape, or form perform any actions to take care of these areas with inclement climates where they are 100% guaranteed to happen? In fact, what was it, a few weeks ago, a month plus ago, we literally had an oil spill where the ocean was on fire. And that's the kind of thing that we're dealing with consistently. Even in the Gulf of Mexico, this has been happening quite often. And these just keep happening in more and more locations. And the effects in the Arctic can be drastic. It's worth noting that environment and wildlife are deeply impacted. As a matter of fact, oil and gas drilling contributes to climate change, not just from the gas, but it again affects the wildlife and communities and will have greater impacts on a lot of different spaces. Our ability to respond, as I've mentioned, with oil spills is severely limited, and it would make any spill that much worse to the wildlife in the area. So to examine polar bears, they spend most of their lives in the sea. So if an oil spill happens, they will naturally get some of that on their fur. They are marine mammals. They're talented swimmers who spend more than half their time hunting food. Food which may also end up covered in oil, especially the seals. Now the oil and gas drilling of their habitat could be extremely damaging, especially if the direct contact that I mentioned could be noted to kill them or to provide toxicity when they consume it off of another animal. The oil can linger in ice and water for an extended period of time and affect parts of the ecosystem for years to come. When it comes to walruses, walruses have a tendency to feed on clams, snails, and marine worms. Now, a lot of those creatures could in fact get oil and gas deposits on them, and if they do, then the walruses would eat them. Now, it's worth noting that many indigenous people in the Arctic rely on walruses for food security and part of their cultural practices. So should this increase happen, it will be these indigenous communities as well as the walrus populations that are impacted, and potentially could create dangerous side effects. If these populations start dying out, it could have an effect on the indigenous communities, and it could make it more dangerous for walruses as a whole. And if they are ingesting oil and then indigenous communities were to consume said animals or to use their fat, who knows what kind of effect that might have on their day-to-day life. Another one that will be affected is beluga whales. We're communicating through a series of chirps, clicks, and whistles and squeals. They are known as the canaries of the sea. Oil and gas development, particularly the use of seismic testing underneath the water, ends up causing it so that these equipment can cause sensitivity to these sounds, where it could end up affecting the communication of the whales, causing them to separate, which could cause young to die, and could cause other versions of damage to their species. The rise of the industry would also increase the number of shipping vessels in the water. That would in turn heighten the amount of noise levels underwater, making communication also further difficult. So it's the equipment that's being used and the shipment lanes that would have to be devised. That's, of course, assuming any of the ships could get through the Arctic in the first place. Now we come to seals, where it's known that the exposure to oil could injure or kill seals. And again, when it kills them, that will affect the polar bear populations. And again, this all ends up maneuvering around each other. And this is just a few examples. It could have impacts on other creatures as well. It could certainly have other impacts on communities, and it may, in fact, cause a lot of damage to fish. And that's the one that really wasn't listed there, but that could be devastating, especially when Greenland is a place that relies on fisheries quite often for food production and for economic factors. The fact of the matter is that drilling for oil, even if it is guaranteed to be economically profitable, will have these far-reaching impacts on the environment, and people will be affected from a number of different standpoints. It will affect indigenous populations and communities. It will affect the wildlife. It will cause spills to be guaranteed, with little to no possibility of an actual cleanup due to how dangerous and difficult it would be. It would be far greater for humanity to start to take the time to start looking towards alternatives. That isn't even counting the amount of damage that using the oil and gas would cause, especially given all of the effects of climate change and the extreme weather we've seen over the past month or so. We really need to start looking at renewable energy. That needs to be the direction that we go in. And as I mentioned previously before, but just going over it a little bit again, one of the last things really to keep in mind in all of this is as the planet warms due to the effects of climate change from using oil, a lot of the ice in these areas are going to melt and the areas are going to thaw out. And as that becomes more consistent, we may see less marsh lands form or marshy weather form, with the areas being a lot drier and a lot more available for these companies to cheaply come in and to receive oil and extract it from the land during the summer months. A lot of the geological surveys from today are really mapping out the potential resources, the potential profit, and the future exploitation of the planet and the resources that are available in the near future. It will be even more important for areas like Greenland to keep their positions and to hold them steady in the future. And while this is a really great thing to see in the moment, we need more places to continue and to follow in Greenland's footsteps and again to hold the line in this regard. There needs to be a push for the development of renewable energy sources. Otherwise, we will continue to produce a cyclical process where as these territories thaw out, they will continue to be exploited more and more for years to come. And the more the temperature rises and the more these areas get dry, the further up into the Arctic we can go and the more that we will seek a lot of these resources. And the Antarctic is presumed to be rich in oil as well. It's just that no companies really have the ability to extract from the Antarctic as well. And that's really part of this. In all of this, it's just a matter of trying to map out and figure out where these resources are going to become available and how they can be exploited. So with that said, if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up, hit the subscribe button and bell for notifications. You can follow me on Twitter and check out my Discord in the description down below. My name is Anarchist Tara, and I thank you for watching.